Welcome, everyone. I know many of you, but my name is J.P. Eggers, and I am the Vice Dean for MBA and Graduate Programs here at NYU Stern. And we're thrilled to have everyone here to join us today on a pretty snowy day here in New York, but really excited to be able to have this conversation and be able to bring this to you and give you all a chance to hear from Dr. Marchetti, but also kind of a chance to maybe ask some questions and kind of think a little bit about how this story and his background applies to some of the things that you're looking at. Before I hand it over to Professor Banaki and Professor Sardari, I just want to thank them both very much for helping to put this together. It's really a true honor and a pleasure to have a guest like Dr. Marchetti joining us today. And I really want to thank them for all their efforts to make this happen today. So with that and with no further ado, let me turn it over to Professor Banaki and Professor Sardari to kind of get us started here today.
Hi, good morning to everyone. Thanks, Vice Dean Eggers, for introducing this webinar and for participating to the panel discussion later on. I also want to thank Tomai, which is the director of the Fashion and Luxury MBA, for being the engine and really the soul of this webinar. So my main task here is to introduce our guest speaker. And let me start really by thanking Federico for accepting our invitation and for adjusting to the program changes due to the pandemic. It's really a pleasure and an honor to introduce a successful Italian entrepreneur to the STER community. And when Tomai and I were looking for a keynote speaker, we had three main goals in mind. We were looking to someone who could speak for both the fashion and the tech students who sit together in my accounting class. We were looking for someone that could extend the idea of information for decision-making out of the financial data domain. And we also look for someone who can inspire MBA students and give a vision for the future. So Federico Marchetti, who is the chairman of York's Net-a-Porter Group, is the independent director of Giorgio Armani, was the first and the only candidate in our list that could add up all these characteristics. And as you may know, Dr. Marchetti has revolutionized the fashion industry, and he was defined by the New York Times as the man who put fashion on the net. Marchetti founded York's in 2000, way before the launch of Facebook and iPhone. This was long before the e-commerce became part of our everyday lives. Dr. Marchetti knows how powerful it is to complement financial data with non-financial data on customer behavior. Both are crucial for a good decision-making process, and in my experience, are forgotten. In most of the cases are forgotten in the fashion industry, where most of the decisions are driven by creativity. And finally, Federico can inspire the MBA students for what he did. He followed his dream and founded York's, went public in 2009. And as of today, York's is the only Italian unicorn. But most importantly, maybe for today's speech, he can inspire all of us for what is doing advancing the sustainability and social responsible in fashion. I just want to mention that recently, the Prince of Wales invited Federico Marchetti to take on the role of chair of the Fashion and Textile Task Force for the Sustainable Market Initiative. So sustainability and data are the best keywords to describe Federico's approach to business. And this is also, if we want, the main theme of this conversation, how data and innovation can turn fashion more sustainable. So I think we are all curious to know what is his vision for the future of sustainability and fashion. So let only a couple of logistics information. Right after the Federico talk, there will be a panel session with both JP and Tomai interacting with Federico. And during the speech, you can use the Q&A button at the bottom of the screen if you want to make some question, and we will pick some of the question in the end. So Federico, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you so much for the introduction. Hello, everybody. I'm Federico. Also, for the following questions, you can call me Federico without doctor or mister. You can go straight to Federico. I'm a little bit more American in this than the Italian dottore. I'm very happy to be here with you. New York is my second home, a city that I love and I miss very much since the travel ban has prevented me from visiting. And I did my MBA at Columbia University, which is your neighbor. And every time I can come to New York, for me, it's a real pleasure. Actually, after the MBA, I didn't want to go back to Italy, but I decided to go back to Italy because I had this dream of this venture. And I thought that being based in Italy was going to be a huge competitive advantage because of the capital of fashion industry, which is split between Milan and Paris, so which is in Europe. So let's start from this video.
Is designed for speed, minimizing drag and supersonic performance.
Throwaway fashion. It seems utter madness to have this approach which takes, makes, and throws away.
Extracting value from data is key.
In this video, you have seen a mix of ventures that are very, very different. So, for example, you have seen the Boom, which is the supersonic jet that incorporates technology and sustainability into vehicle design with 100% carbon neutrality. And it can travel from New York to London in only 3.5 hours compared to the around 6-7 hours that it takes usually to, I don't know, with British Airways. Then, I mean, you all know Elon Musk, the electric car champion, that said quite recently, humanity needs to go to Mars to help alleviate overpopulation and ensure the survival of the species. And if you don't do something soon, Earth will not have much time left. We have to save our beautiful, precious Earth. Then, I mean, it's a completely different story, but still, it's very relevant for the fashion industry because Prince Charles and I, we have invented a new blueprint for the fashion industry, which is called the Modern Artisan. So on one side, we tried to revitalize and reinvent the old job, the very traditional job of the artisan by giving new tools and data and technology to young students. And on the other side, we came up with a sustainable collection, fully sustainable from A to Z, including also digital ID that I will tell you more later. So, which is really a new way of doing fashion. And this one is the socks that you've seen that is definitely different from the supersonic jet. For example, I didn't know that it takes 1,200 liters of water to produce a single cotton sock. And we have, as a Yoox Net-a-Porter, we have invested in this startup as part of our Vogue Yoox Challenge, that is a program that we launch every year. So all of these are very different, but they have something in common, which is a sustainability and innovation technology at the heart. And these two worlds are the key to tomorrow, the two greatest challenges and opportunities before us, challenges it is imperative for us to focus on and work on for the future. And so I think that you, by graduating at NYU, you have a great opportunity in front of you because definitely the world will change after COVID. There was already like some strong seeds of digitalization and sustainability before COVID, and definitely with COVID, everything has had a huge acceleration. So I think definitely in terms of entrepreneurialism, you will have a great opportunity in front of us to invent new things by using these two ingredients, which is innovation and sustainability. Everything has changed now in the last year. Changes are occurring in all aspects of our lives. So how we work, how we travel, mobility, the food that we eat, the clothes that we wear, the way in which we communicate, for example, now. On September 15, 2015, governments of the 193 member countries of the United Nations approved the 2030 Agenda Sustainable Development. And this document lays out the 17 Sustainable Development Goals, which aim to end poverty and hunger and protect human rights and human dignity, to protect the planet from degradation and foster peace by 2030, with an investment of $7 trillion per year. We need to create a new era. We need to believe that the fourth industrial revolution will come by means of green energy and technology. And all over the world, architects are planning new smart cities where digital networks are enter physical spaces. These new intelligent cities are green, they save energy, they deal with waste, and they make civic participation a priority. In the 90s, I remember the American architect and computer scientist Nicholas Negroponte, I think from MIT, if I'm not wrong, said that the study of a city couldn't be limited to just atoms anymore, but had to extend also to bytes, or rather the data that is collected and exchanged with a sequence of zeros and ones, which is, by the way I called it UX back in 99 when I invented this project, which is the Y and X, which are the chromosomes, and the zero, which is the DNA of the technology. So DNA of human, men and women, and the DNA of technology. And Singapore is also an interesting example of a city. Through an app is managing the access of cars in the most heavily congested areas at rush hour. And today this sort of technology is used to experiment in experiments of self-driving cars. The opportunity is to make streets safer and to reduce the number of vehicles in circulation. So the bottom line is that the world is in a phase of deep change, and COVID-19 has brought our priorities to the fore. Priorities we can no longer ignore. And these priorities means that the technology is not the end goal. Technology is just the way we can forge our future. So it's the means through which we can reach the end goal. So it's very important to give ourselves some objectives. This is the for I'm sure that you all know, but this is the famous office of Apple in Cupertino that, frankly, I went also to visit a couple of years ago, and it's really amazing. In the center, I think if I remember well, the employees they can plant trees. And it's fully sustainable in terms of energy and in terms of collaboration. That was the idea of Steve Jobs, that I had also the honor to exchange emails with quite a long time ago when I wanted to present him this concept of fashion and technology together. I think probably 15 years ago. So I still have the emails that I exchanged with Steve Jobs. And I remember that his email was iCEO, like iPad, iPhone. And definitely he's someone who helped my business to grow immensely, because currently we sell over $1 billion through the smartphone that he invented. Even if I came up with the idea of selling fashion, as Professor mentioned before, quite early on in 1999. So this is Homo Faber. I'm sure you know this image because it's quite a universal image. And this mix, or let's put it in this way, this balance between human and machine has inspired my career and my strategies and my vision since the very beginning. Because I thought that on one hand, I was dealing with luxury, that is all about quality, emotions, craftsmanship. And on the other side also, I wanted to reinvent and revolutionize and disrupt the fashion industry through technology, as I mentioned before, as a mean to change the status quo. And this balance has guided me across my career, because I've made many, many decisions and many strategies where I decided voluntarily to put myself in the right balance between human and machine. So I could have used technology much more than I did, but I thought that for my industry and for the fashion industry, was important to keep the right balance also about human and quality and emotions that are the inspirations for customers to buy fashion and luxury. I think this balance will continue in the future, also beyond the fashion industry, because we are entering in this technology era, in this fourth revolution. And to keep the balance will be so relevant in the future as it was for me in the last 20 years. Actions and creativity that during humanism were best represented by craftsmanship and Leonardo da Vinci inventions. So I'm bringing Leonardo da Vinci not only because I'm Italian, even if the French managed to call him Leonard da Vinci with the biggest exhibition at the Louvre, and they pretended that Leonardo was French, but he was Italian, and everybody knows that he was a genius, that he came up with the new technologies. At the time invented basically everything, even probably you don't know, but I believe that Leonardo was the one who invented also the internet, because he wrote in the Code Atlanticus, which is in a Milanese library now, he wrote that one day people will talk each other, even from remote countries, and they will communicate each other without basically being in presence. So, which is basically what we're doing now with the Zoom tonight. And so Leonardo, many, many, many hundreds years ago, was something that he had, through his immense imagination, thought that it was possible to happen. So now we are talking about AI, data, augmented reality. So all these technologies are very contemporary compared to Leonardo. I don't have definitely Leonardo da Vinci's genius to see half a millennium ahead of his time. But as an entrepreneur, I've been pretty good at guessing what the near future would bring. And following Leonardo's example, I've tended to do this by seeing the convergence of unrelated trends before others did. So how do I do this as an entrepreneur, which is probably something that for people like you, the students, they want to have their own startup soon, maybe it could be helpful to know. By dreaming the future, simply as that. I spend a lot of time dreaming about the future. I really believe that if you want to change the world, you have to imagine what the world would look like. And the image can be completely fuzzy, completely not definitely defined in everything, but I think the power of imagination, even in a technology era, will continue to be so important to continue to have a continuous progress and a continuous improvement in everything that we do. Now we talk about the fashion industry after this, let's say, introduction. The fashion industry is an industry that is beautiful, is like glamorous. So when I started, I remember that I'm not coming from the fashion industry. I'm not coming even from a programming background, but I've been really at the intersection between fashion and technology from the very beginning, and trying to be the link between these two worlds that in 2099, they were completely different and separate, and they looked at each other actually with suspicion. The fashion industry is the second biggest polluter in the world. And also e-commerce actually is criticized for using planes and lorries to transport goods around the world and for increasing traffic in cities with deliveries and returns. And that's why my friend, Jeff Bezos, has communicated a few years ago that he wanted to start the deliveries by drone. And by the way, this morning I was looking at a startup that is starting actually to deliver in Ireland groceries with drones. So it's happening. I think he communicated this before Christmas. It was a great communication tool, probably 5 or 7 years ago. And it's actually happening. Probably he was dreaming about it. Probably it was his imagination, but it's currently happening. So how can you break this vicious circle of the fashion industry in terms of, you can read here, the fashion industry may use a quarter of the world's carbon budget by 2050. 40% of the clothing purchased by women are impulse buys, and over 50% of the clothing in our wardrobe never get worn, which is something that we know also, not only women, but also men. And 127 billion worth of garments that are at risk of having modern slavery in their supply chain are imported annually by G20 countries. So how can you break this vicious circle? So the term sustainability comes from the Latin word sustinere, which meant to keep, to preserve. Sustain is also a piano pedal, or a key in electronic pianos. It is the one that holds the sound for longer. So to me, sustainable fashion is about finding a piece that you love and want to wear again and again. It is about beautiful design, thoughtful craftsmanship, and in creating pieces that can be cherished for a lifetime and beyond. It is about having confidence that the choices you're making are not damaging people or the planet. And actually, this was the initial idea of YOOX, that then it was merged with Net-a-Porter. Now it's called my group that I'm honored to be the chairman of, is called YOOX Net-a-Porter. But the original idea of YOOX was basically the one of circular fashion, because it started everything from the end of season. So how to give a second life to the product that was the leftover from shops, from brands, from multi-brand retailers and so on. And it was, so now it's even more contemporary than in 2000 when I launched it. What's the bottom line? That we need to change the rules, innovate and build new principles and do it fast. And being pioneers and breaking down barriers is the key to winning. So now I mention pioneering. In my bio, I wrote tech entrepreneur, because I've started in 99 with this startup called YOOX, and I wrote also sustainability pioneer. Why? Because in 2009, which is almost 12 years ago, definitely for the fashion industry was ahead of its time, I start to imagine that sustainability was going to be the keyword in fashion soon. And I launched this project called Uxygen. It was not only to sell sustainable fashion within UX, within a special area of UX with special content and special clothes that only made by sustainable materials. But it was a huge project that touched so many aspects of the company life. So, for example, the packaging, no? Because we are shipping millions and millions of orders, and at that time we were shipping boxes that were not recycled, and so I started in 2009 to ship only recycled boxes. Then I started to have only hybrid cars for the company management, the top management. And then the buildings, I started to launch this project to have only renewable energy. And so basically it was a very comprehensive 360 degrees project around sustainability for the whole company. And also we launched the first sustainability report. By the way, we went public in 2009, so we went public with obviously the financial statements, according to IFRS, with the auditors and so on, and also the sustainability report. So it was super innovative for that time, because I thought that it was the way to go. And and when I merged with Net-a-Porter in 2015, with the merger effective in 2016, I realized that we were much, much more advanced and innovative than our colleagues in Great Britain. And so what we did, we imported all the best practice from UX also to Net-a-Porter. Now the whole group is at the same level. And I would say that in terms of as an e-tailer, as an e-commerce operator in the fashion industry, we are definitely at the forefront of sustainability. In fact, last December, so basically a couple of months ago, we launched this big project, which is more than a project, is a strategy, a vision for the future of our group, which is called Infinity, Lasting Luxury Fashion and Lasting Positive Impact. Lasting Luxury Fashion, because that's exactly what we sell. So we don't sell fast fashion, but we sell luxury and fashion that it can be passed from generation to generation. So with the long term, with longevity, and a lasting positive impact, because that's what we want to do. We are not there yet. We are not at 100%. But as I mentioned before, we have our own objectives that I will tell you more now. And we wanted to reach them in the next few years. We'll be right back. So this is our plan for the future. It started, as I said, everything started in 2009. So this is just an acceleration of what I started in 2009. And I am very proud to say that I feel it's my legacy for YOOX NET-A-PORTER in the future. And I'm very proud that they will continue, even if I'm not the chief executive officer anymore, because I decided 3 years ago to, let's say, to end my contract in 2021. And so 1 year ago, I decided to launch the succession. And last November, we finally announced the successor. And I'm staying as a chairman for the transition. But this is my legacy, and I'm very happy that the group will continue forever and for the next 20, 30 years to lead the fashion industry in terms of sustainability. What is about Infinity? So Infinity is a 10-year strategy, so 2020-2030, so very much aligned with the UN objectives that I mentioned before, that commits to 4 focus areas. So circular business, circular culture, planet positive, and people positive. Each one designed to advance our ambition to providing circular luxury fashion to the world and to connect people with the joy of luxury and fashion that lasts a lifetime and beyond. Through these areas and time-bound commitments with each, we will contribute to 7 of the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals across areas such as climate action, responsible consumption, inequality, just to name a few. So let's have a look at the first one, you know, the circular business. Enhance our ecosystem to empower fashion that never ends. So we wanted to promote an ecosystem that stands behind quality, craftsmanship, designed well, designed to last, designed to be reloved and remade. And tech and innovation will be key allies to unleash our group's circular potential. Here, our commitments, now, because we just don't want to make statements. We wanted to have clear objectives in mind to measure during these years. So we'll start first with design, where everything begins with. So to make sure the products we buy or design ourselves through our own private labels are developed with circularity in mind, we have developed sustainable and circular product guidelines. Because with YOOX, we have our own private label, which is called Otto 8. With Mr. Porter, we have our own private label, which is called Mr. P. With The Outlet, we have our own private label, which is called Iris and Ink. And with NET-A-PORTER, we don't have a private label yet. So we also make these guidelines available to all our brand partners to encourage circular thinking in the wider industry. But first, we start with our own labels, which is simply easier. Second, we will unlock e-commerce options through new technologies. Third, we'll make clothes last for longer by setting up a partnership for care and repair services for our customers, which is something actually that now I remember that I did also like, I think, soon after I launched Yuxygen, the project that I mentioned before, I launched also another project around shoes. And at that time also we put in contact our customers with the network of artisans for shoe care and repair. So this is again something that is developing along the last 10 years. Let's see the case study for this circular business is the digital ID. So last year we ran 2 digital ID pilots across select items from the latest Mr. P collection for Mr. Porter and the entire YOOX NET-A-PORTER for Prince Foundation collection, which is the modern artisan that I mentioned before. We are now working to develop the proposition tailoring QR codes into each product of our private labels, giving customer access to a unique digital ID. Unique digital IDs are virtual certificates that can be used to record each item's history, telling its history from manufacture through use, resale, reuse, and recycling. And also, for example, in the case of the modern artisan, through the QR code, you could also see the history of that piece in terms of the materials used, in terms of the love by the artisans, in terms of the concept by the students when they designed it. So also the story behind each of the items. And this technology will allow customers and partners to easily check an individual garment's authenticity, provenance, history, and consideration for styling and care and repair so that it can last for longer and encourage a circular mindset. So this basically, the digital ID brings transparency, which is the ABC for any circular business. So when you have transparency, you have information, and you know what you're really buying. Something that is already happening, I think, in the food industry. So you know that particular meat is coming from the Regione Lombardia, or is coming from Ireland, or is coming from Scotland, the salmon, or whatever. In this case, we are applying the same concept, the same principle to the fashion industry. Then we have a circular culture. Circular culture makes circular luxury available, desirable, intuitive for all our customers. So enhancing our own business ecosystem is one route to a circular future, but it is only effective if it goes hand in hand with a shift in culture. So culture is what we're trying to raise in terms of awareness. Customers are the center of everything that we do. So we see a real opportunity and a great responsibility to use our platforms, our followers, 15 million followers on social media, or like we have a magazine, which is called Porter Magazine. We have, our own website, apps. So we're talking about over a billion people visiting per year all of our four brands, YOOX, Net-a-Porter, Mr. Porter, and The Outnet. And I'm not talking about the B2B business, which is like powering the online flagship stores for Armani.com, Valentino.com, and many other powerful brands. Our commitments are, so we will do this by increasing the availability of sustainable luxury. So currently the sustainable luxury in our assortment is still a single digit percentage. So we wanted to increase it until we reach a point where net sustain, which is the area of sustainable fashion, and Net-a-Porter and Yuxygen, which is the area of sustainable fashion in Yux. Our dedicated sustainable shopping edits are not exceptions. Currently are more, are definitely less than the rest. So we want to grow these two areas, not to be the exception anymore, but to be the norm. And second, harnessing the power of editorial content to inform and inspire. As a group, we're committing 20% of our editorial content, including social, to sustainability and circularity. And third, using our technological and data expertise and customer insights to empower conscious and informed ways of shopping. Let's think to greener shipping methods, for example, but also sizing tools and virtual try-ons to reduce carbon emissions. And for example, we've launched at Yux, this so-called Yux Mirror, which is a kind of a virtual try-on within the app where customers can try on the clothes directly in the app, which hopefully will reduce the returns, and actually more than hopefully, because the launch has been extremely successful, and we've seen this feature to be used during the Christmas holidays. It's the most used feature by all of our customers, and is already proving that augmented reality, artificial intelligence, definitely can help to reduce the returns going forward. So these are the two areas, the case studies, that I mentioned before. One is within Net-a-Porter, the other one is in Yux. Two different DNAs, two different brand assortment, two different propositions to the customers, also in terms of price points. And as I mentioned, Uxygen was launched in 2009 during the Earth Day and NetSustain in 2019. 10 years later, but also like before the launch of NetSustain, Net-a-Porter was developing a lot of sustainable fashion also in the years before. And for us, helping our customers to make better choices is a process that starts long before products hit the store. It begins with scouting and supporting sustainable fashion brands, identifying powerful partnerships that can make a positive social impact, and setting out a clear definition of what sustainability and circularity means. Planet positive commitments. So it means operate in line with science to have a lasting positive impact on the planet. Becoming a circular business will mean that we are already making a positive impact on our planet by promoting longevity and reducing waste. But we wanted to do more, and so we have made additional commitments to operate in line with science. Our commitments are, first, becoming climate positive across our operations and private labels by 2030. And to do this, we will decrease our business carbon emissions through a radical reduction strategy in line with the science-based target. Invest in offsetting projects to mitigate the emissions that we are unable to avoid in the short term. In other words, planting trees around the world as much as we can in order to mitigate the impact. And for our second commitment, we will keep working with our partners to champion responsible practices within our value chain, as we believe in supply chains that are systematically sustainable for people and nature. Let's all remember that our responsibility does not stop with our own operations. We need to ensure that all brands and partners we decide to work with share our same values towards people and the planet. And we will be protecting natural ecosystems, which is the third one, becoming a zero waste business and ensuring that 100% of all waste generated by our offices and distribution centers is reused, recycled, or composted. So this is the result of our, let's say, of our mission in terms of being planet positive. So we have an electric fleet, which is in London, New York, Milan, that is was launched recently. Soon Dubai and all wherever we have, let's say, distribution centers in the future. Renewable energy also is a key climate solution, and I'm glad to say, I'm super happy to say that during this conversation with you, that today we already use in 2020 100% renewable energy throughout our own operations and vehicles, which is basically we met the objective sooner than we said and we expected. And last but not least, people positive commitments, people positive, because we wanted to champion diversity and inclusivity to unlock opportunities for our business industry and beyond, because we strongly believe that it is impossible to achieve environmental progress without social progress too. So it's all interconnected, as you can imagine. And these are our commitments in this area. So, first, nurturing emerging talent is crucial to creating a sustainable future for our industry and has always been close to our heart and my heart. We want to break down barriers to entry and equip talent with the right skills for the future, enabling a sustainable pipeline for luxury and technology. On this, I led by example, by launching a mentorship program last year for aspiring entrepreneurs from backgrounds that are typically underrepresented in the industry. And I already did a mentorship to more than a dozen of young entrepreneurs that wanted to launch their own startup with follow-ups, with advice, with concrete advice and also concrete support, connecting them with investors or with logistics centers or giving advice of what not to do, which mistake not to make. And so on. And it's been actually very inspiring also for me to do this. Second, we will advocate for inclusion and champion diverse perspectives at every level within our business. And for this reason, I'm a founding member since a couple of years of the Champions of Change Global Technology Group. It's a coalition which works to promote gender equality in the tech sector, because as you know, in the tech sector, the women representation is very low. The Silicon Valley is around half of Hughes Net-a-Porter percentage of women in tech. And we will use, third, we'll use our platforms and global influence to amplify and accelerate campaigns, organizations, businesses, individuals that champion inclusivity and bring the voices of underrepresented groups to the forefront of the fashion industry. We've established partnerships that contribute to building a more equal world since our very beginning, since 20 years, supporting and raising awareness of causes such as women's empowerment and men's health, men's mental health. Yeah, women empowerment has been very close to me and to my heart from the very beginning. I just mentioned some examples. 50% of our executive committee is made by women. 2/3 of our employees are women. There's no a gap in terms of a pay gap in Italy, women and men, which is like for Italy, is basically, it's a very, very rare thing to happen. I've just listened, I think last night, the speech, the introductory speech of our new prime minister, which is Mr. Draghi, that mentioned that there is Italy is very, 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 very behind in terms of pay gap, in terms of women representation. So I'm happy to say that Hughes Net-a-Porter is an Anglo-Italian company, because the headquarters are two, one in Milan and one in London. But for everything that has to do with Italy, we are definitely at the forefront of women representation. And this is something that has been dear to me from the very beginning. As you can see, most of these things, they're not a presentation that we put together quickly in December just because it is trendy. It's something that there are seeds that I started in 2000, including emerging talents. I remember in 2011, I started also with new fashion designers this program together with my dear friend, that unfortunately she passed away, Franca Sozzani, in order to help young fashion designers. And this is a program that is continuing since 2011 until now. Now it's called the Vobius Challenge. It is more about sustainability and also including startups and young innovators, like the salty water that I mentioned before, where we have given our, let's say, financing. And in terms of fashion designers, one of them, and probably one of the most famous, is J.W. Anderson, that is now designing for the LVMH group. He started with this program that was invented by Frank and I. And so, all of these missions are something that we've been working on, but now at least they have, with Infinity, they have a plan, clear objectives. We want to be measured more and more. We have we want to, all of our employees, we want to be involved, for example, in the mentorship program and in voluntary work. We've asked each of our employees to provide voluntary work in 2021, because I think that it's in the DNA of our group, of our companies, Hughes Net-a-Porter. So this is a funny picture, because believe it or not, Prince Charles, His Royal Highness Prince Charles, is a very, very authentic, but also funny, and with great irony and humor, British humor, of course. And I've enjoyed this project so much because we share the same values. I mean, he's an authentic champion of sustainability, starting in 1969, and the year I was born. So we're talking about 50 years ago. People were making fun of him. At the beginning, probably some professors know, you probably don't know, but long time ago, people were thinking of him that he was a bit weird, you know, to think about all these eco, screen and so on. But he was ahead of his time, simply ahead of his time. And I met him. We shared immediately the same values, actually. In terms of longevity of the product, he showed me his shoes that he was wearing since 20 years. And I showed him my suit that I was wearing since 10 years. And we start laughing also because we found out that we had common friends. And from that moment on, we launched this beautiful project that I came up with in terms of the idea, the Modern Artisan. It was a huge success globally because, I don't know, we had a huge publicity around over 1,000 articles and features in every publication of the world, from Korea to, I mean, just name any country. We sold most of the collection within 2 weeks. And so all the proceeds and proceeds that went to is a foundation that is providing and giving jobs to all the young people and the young community that is in Scotland around this estate, which is called Dumfries House. So it's a beautiful project that we are continuing the episode 2 in the years to come. And after the success of this project, he asked me also to chair this, let's say, fashion and textile program within the macro and ambitious project that is called the Sustainable Markets Initiative that he launched last year at Davos. And this year with Macron, which is the president of France, together with the Terra Carta, which is basically his manifesto of what he wants to do. So I have Infinity with Yves Saint Laporte, yes, Terra Carta. I invite you all to read the Terra Carta. You can Google it, Terra Carta. It's a very ambitious program that touches many, many industries with ambitious goals, with clear objectives. And so he really wants to help the planet to be better. And so I'm very proud and honored to be his Italian friend, in a way. Conclusions. The fourth industrial revolution has begun. It is now entirely up to us. And so you are native digitals, more or less. You know technology very well, definitely better than in the old generation. Try to use it to clean up the oceans from plastic, to foster biodiversity, to end global warming, to come up with zero impact solutions. You can help repair our beautiful world by putting together innovation, creativity, and sustainability all together. And your dreams to create a better world can now become true, because I really think you have an amazing opportunity in front of us by being a student at NYU and soon being, let's say, in the workplace, inventing jobs or working for companies, because I think that you're going to be in a new era with a lot of change, with a lot of growth, definitely a different growth, more sustainable growth, but with a lot of opportunities for those ones of you that wanted to become entrepreneur, and also for great opportunities also for those ones that wanted to work for non-profit organization or become managers of incredible companies that are gonna grow and gonna do and gonna be very successful in these areas of sustainability and innovation together. Thank you very much. Now I open to questions. That is the most interesting part.
Thanks a lot, Federico, for this inspiring presentation and for your vision on the future. I would like to ask JP to start with a question, because I mean the main focus is tech and fashion. So I would ask JP to start with a question that most likely is more related to tech than fashion.
Yeah, and there's a bunch of great questions that have come in the chat too. So I want to make sure we get a chance to come to some of those as well. But I did want to start with kind of bringing it back a little bit to the technology. You know, when I think about Amazon, for example, Amazon started with books, because books are easy to sell online, right? It's a standard product. It's easy. You know what you're going to get. Music, video games, things like that. Fashion's really hard. It's, you know, as you talked a little bit about, and you mentioned the Yolks Mirror kind of initiative that you've put in place recently. Can you talk a little bit about the challenges of trying to sell a product that usually is driven by touch, by feel, by look, by getting a chance to try things on, selling that online, and what that's been like, and what and how technology has played a role in helping to enable you to be so successful doing this?
Thank you for the question. So I'll try to be brief, so we leave 30 minutes for many, many questions, hopefully. And then if you want to follow up more, ask me more. But when I launched Yolks, definitely your question was very, very relevant because no one was doing it, simply as that. Actually, I launched, I invented Yolks in 99, and I launched the first day of launch was June 20th, 2000. So I got the first funding from a VC in March 2003, 3 months later, I opened the doors of this, the virtual doors of Yolks.com. And at that time, I remember that a journalist called me, actually from Netherlands. I don't ask me why from Netherlands. No, maybe because, maybe I know why, because from the very beginning, Yolks.com was a pan-European project. So even if I had only 3 months to launch and to put together the warehouse, the product, the systems, the people, the team, in order to get to the second round of financing, and I managed to do so in 3 months, I decided that I didn't want to launch only an Italian project, but I wanted Yolks.com to be immediately pan-European. So in terms of language, Italian and English, but also in terms of shipping, deliveries. At the time, we had many, many currencies because we had the Italian lira, the French franc, the German mark, and so on. And so it was pretty complex to do it like that in 3 months. But at that time, and that's why this Dutch journalist called me and he said, it was basically a couple of months after the burst of the bubble. No, if you remember in 2000, there were, I mean, there are many books that they say in the spring 2000, the bubble of the new economy burst and the stock exchange collapsed. No one believed anymore in the e-commerce, in technology, in the internet. So everything before everything was internet, after nothing is internet. So I was exactly in the middle of it. Imagine. And this journalist called me and said, are you crazy? So he started the conversation by phone saying, are you crazy? And I said, no, I'm not crazy. I have a vision. And the vision is that this is a thing and it will happen. And probably it was a bit too early because I remember that the modem was 56K. So the site was slow. There were no, the apps didn't exist. But as I mentioned before, it was a, my imagination, that probably at the business school you call it vision, and like what you call vision, I call it imagination, which is in my mind is a bit more creative, made me think about the future. And I think that technology now, 20 years later, actually 21 years later, there is no CEO in the fashion industry that doesn't have digital as a top priority, as a actually priority number one in his agenda. Because of COVID, there's been definitely an acceleration. So with the shops closed, the only way to sell and the only way to continue to communicate with the customers has been just the digital part of these brands. But also because the two things, the world of technology, the world of luxury, they can coexist very well together because one is a content producer, which is the fashion industry. The other one needs content all the time. And fashion is a great content. So after Hollywood, probably after movies, I think the greatest content producer with fashion shows, celebrities, great products, great stories is the fashion industry. So I think the two worlds Now that they've come basically one world, which is something that I saw in 99.
Tomei, do you want to ask a question or pick from the students' questions? You decide.
Yes. I think I would like to take the students' questions. I see some very interesting ones here. And one has to do with exactly your vision and where fashion is going exactly as you finish this last answer. Someone is asking about all the new technologies that are changing or otherwise bringing together fashion and try to maintain that balance between tech and human touch. And in luxury fashion particularly, which is so important. So we have a blending of the experience of in-store and online, VR, AR, all sorts of interesting technologies. And so how do you see brands successfully keeping that human touch and experience that is so central to your vision?
Yeah, I think it's a great question because the answer is very difficult. In the sense that, as I mentioned before, the balance between human and machine is what I think is needed for this industry. I give you some examples because I think it's always better to talk by examples. For example, we believe in machine learning, and we think also the machine can learn style, which is something that you can. I mean, many people do not have style. And but the machines, can they learn style? We believe so. And so we have very talented stylists around the world, in New York, in London, in Milan, in Tokyo, in Shanghai, in our offices around the world. We have very, very talented stylists that are working with us since 20 years and will continue to work with us for the next 20 years. And the machines are learning all the style in order to give our personal shoppers recommendation for our customers. So this is the perfect balance between human and machine. It could have been completely different because I could have had the machine learning the style, firing all the stylists and giving directly to the customers the recommendation of style, which is something that I would never do because I think that it's important, first of all, to have a human interaction with the personal shoppers. So it's better that we give some recommendation to the personal shoppers that in their turn, they speak with the customers. A second, because of the talent, the human talent of our stylists is irreplaceable. It cannot be replaced, but we can have machines that are learning from them. So if this is an example of the perfect balance, and maybe someone else would have done completely different, would have done, you know what, I will push the cursor to 100% technology. In my case, I pushed it to 50% technology and 50% human talent. So I think it's a decision, it's a strategy. And it depends from the CEOs of different brands, of the different retailers, of the different e-tailers, of the different e-commerce operators. I think it depends from them. I believe that our strategy is the right strategy for the luxury industry in the digital world.
And I was about to say that this definitely aligns with the definition that we have about what luxury is, because luxury is a really high touch sector, which brings me to an original question I wanted to ask you. And I still have this curiosity after I heard how you started. What were some of the first brands that you were onboarding as soon as you launched Yuke's? And what was it that made you believe that they should be part of your new universe and this new brand that you were establishing? Was it how commercially successful they were in the luxury sector? Was it their resonance to culture? or had you already started envisioning that direction into sustainability and that allowed you to be selective and set criteria?
I'm gonna tell you an answer that will probably disappoint you very, very much from an academic point of view. I mentioned before that I had 3 months to basically put together from the first financing that was a 1.5 million euro to the launch of Yux.com. I had only 3 months to put everything together. So I was by myself with 1.5 million euro in March 2000. Imagine.
Yeah.
And I had to prove the investors to get the second round of financing in the middle of the burst of the bubble economy. So basically they couldn't wait that I didn't manage to meet the milestone, not right. to give me the money, because they were scared, like everybody in the world. In June 2000, they didn't want to invest anymore in e-commerce. So they couldn't wait that I didn't meet the milestone. So I was in that situation. On top of that, I was launching a super innovative business that didn't exist. And so, frankly, through my imagination and also being myself a customer, a potential customer of this shop of my dreams, let's put it this way, I thought that customers may eventually be interested in shopping online fashion. But I couldn't run any survey. I couldn't run because if I was going to ask many customers, would you like to buy fashion online? They were going to tell me, I don't know, because I've never done it. I don't know what you're talking about. So it was really instinctive and inspiration and imagination. At the same time, I couldn't go to the big brand like Gucci or Prada that were currently stock and saying, you know what, I have this dream and I wanted to stock your product, but I've never worked in fashion. I never worked in technology. And now I wanted to launch this website. just making a few millions because, I don't know even if I'm going to get the second round of financing in June 2000. So what I did was something very practical, which entrepreneurs, they always need to do. No, solving problems with practical answers, which is a bit different from, let's say, the academic answer. I started by collecting leftovers from multi-brand retailers, some of the most prestigious in the world, some Colette in Paris, that is, was the temple of fashion where everybody was going to collect every Paris Fashion Week. But at the same time, they had physiologically some leftovers. And so I started from that, getting many different brands, which was perfect to test my idea with the customers rather than just having one brand with 10 items. And that's how I started. Definitely then Yux made the first couple of million euro in revenues in year 2000. So things that they were more concrete, I could approach designers at that point. So, and then I started to knock on doors without being an insider, because as I mentioned, I was an outsider in fashion. And I knocked a few doors. The first one that gave me trust was Armani, which is run by an entrepreneur that is currently 86 years old. So not necessarily the innovators are the young. Sometimes are also the old, because they are wise and they can innovate again and they can try and test new things. So that's why my relationship with Mr. Armani dates back since the year 2001, when he gave me his first products on Yux.com. And that's why now, given this long trust and long relationship, I'm sitting in his board as the only non-family member helping him in terms of the future of his company and the digitalization of his company. Then many others came, all the big Italian brands they follow, and now the situation is completely different. Since 3 or 4 years, with Yoox Net-a-Porter, we are in the position to be very, very selective, because basically there's no brand in the world, except probably for a couple, that they don't aspire to be on Yoox Net-a-Porter, because we are a great window to the world, to 1 billion people, to the most, to the best customers around the world, and so on. So now the wheel of fortune has completely changed in our favor.
Great, thank you for that. Actually, this is a great segue to another student question. And this student is asking exactly this. So Richemont joined Alibaba and Kering in making a large investment in Farfetch. And the main goal is to dominate the Asian markets. How does your parent company's investment in a direct competitor impacts your company? And do you see a differentiation in strategy between Yoox, Net-a-Porter and Farfetch?
Yeah, I mean, I imagine a question like that could come because it could look counterintuitive, understand. But Mr. Johan Rupert, that I had the honor to work with since 2015 with the merger of Net-a-Porter, and also since 2018 when he bought the whole company, that I ran until December, and which now I'm chairman, is a visionary man, definitely. And that's why it could look counterintuitive. And now I try to explain his vision. I mean, first of all, Johan and I, we did the first joint venture with Alibaba in 2018, following the acquisition of Yoox Net-a-Porter by Richemont, which was, a ground breakthrough deal, super innovative, because Alibaba in 2018 was not necessarily, let's put it in this way, considered and perceived luxury, because it was basically more mainstream or mass market as a marketplace. But we thought that with specific constraints and with a dedicated area called the Luxury Pavilion, we could help Alibaba to bring luxury brands to China, and Alibaba helping us to get the Chinese customers through the big ecosystem that in which they operate. So it was a win-win partnership through a joint venture. And it was super innovative. And Johan Rupert and I, he signed the deal because at that time it was already 100% owned by Richemont, my company, and the joint venture started immediately and is already super successful. So it's doing very well. Let's put it this way: great team in China, and so on. Based on the success of this joint venture that we did with Alibaba in 2018, Johan saw the future in China, which is a digital future. And there is another business model, which is the one of the marketplace, which is run by Farfetch. Currently, when I stepped down as a CEO, Yoox Net-a-Porter is still the leader in terms of the online luxury and fashion in the world, in terms of traffic, in terms of revenues, in terms of number of customers, 4.5 million customers, and so on. So Yoox Net-a-Porter is the leading number one player in the industry. But Farfetch is a very, very interesting business model, very, very different from the one of Yoox Net-a-Porter, because one is still a curator and, let's say, as Johan calls it, a selective distributor, because we do selection. We do selection of brands, as I mentioned before, we do selection of items, we do selection of products, and so on. While Farfetch is a marketplace. where basically they don't buy and sell, and they don't operate necessarily big warehouses automated like we do. So they don't control the supply chain from A to Z as we do. But it's a great business model. So Johan, after the success of the joint venture in China that we are operating, he decided that he wanted to explore also the other business model, because it makes sense to explore different avenues of growth, especially now that, as you know, for the luxury industry, the two areas that are growing the most are the digital and China. And so he probably got, I don't know how you say it in English, but in Italian you say due piccioni con una fava.
Oh, yeah.
It's probably Massimiliano.
One stone. Two birds with one stone.
Exactly. Yeah. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Great. Well, go ahead.
No, I saw there is an accounting question, so I wanna play this role. So basically, and it's an interesting question. It says, so what is the effect on the income statement of all these sustainable initiatives, and how do you communicate to your investor this kind of strategy, right? How do you justify? So is it really true that you can create value for the stakeholder and also generate value for the investor, which is a big question also in academia? Mm-hmm. So how do you manage this kind of equilibrium?
Now you're right, because definitely, for example, I remember when I launched the packaging in 2009, the packaging fully recycled and recyclable cost much more than the packaging before. So it's definitely an investment. It has definitely an impact. The digital ID has an impact, because if you wanted to put for each product a digital ID, we're talking about an additional cost for each product. So first of all, since 2009, we have a sustainability report, so everything is transparent. So everything that we do is fully transparent and with an annual report around sustainability. And that's how we report, for example, the recyclable energy or all the activities that we do around sustainability. So basically the investor, the shareholders, that currently is only one shareholder, because after the acquisition of Richemont, they listed the company from the stock exchange. So before I had many shareholders, now I have only one shareholder. But even if you have one shareholder, it's still a shareholder. And so they definitely wanted to see what's going on in terms of transparency of the accounts and so on. And I believe that it's mostly can be perceived as an investment, but at the same time, now I'm an investor myself too. And I see that before investing in a company or in a fund, the first thing that I look at is this, is the sustainability. What is the impact? What is the impact of that business? What is the commitment of that business? And more and more, the funds are specializing in sustainability, not only from a passive point of view, but also from an active point of view. So I do believe that there's definitely a huge value going forward, especially going forward in the future. If you ask me, in the past, probably I was too ahead of the time when I launched this big project that costed a lot of money, a lot of millions, to Hughes and Apporté, to Hughes in 2009. And probably at that time, the investors and the shareholders, they were not so, let's say, intrigued by this. But now, and more in the years to come, I think it will be essential to do it. So I think there's a lot of value.
JP, do you want to pick some of the question or ask your own question? I think we have time for one, maximum two question more.
So I'll try and be quick. There've been a number of questions basically talking about who's responsible.
How many students are connected?
There's 120 attendees.
Good.
So we think
We were 160 at the, maybe in the middle, at the peak, yes.
Yeah. So really the question I think is who's responsible for deciding to push for sustainability? And I say this, and this question came up a couple different ways. One was, how much do you push this on the brands that want to sell through Yuke's, in the sense of, do you push this as a, they need to follow certain guidelines? And is that a role that you clearly, it's a role you think you should be playing, but do you think you should have to play that role? And then the other part of it is, where's the policymaker? Where's the government in terms of pushing for, you know, why is it self-regulation that's kind of leading to this at this point in time? Kind of a broad question on who's responsible, whose responsibility should this be?
Yeah, it's a very important question. I think so. Currently, as I mentioned, sustainability has been at the core of our, let's say, mission since a long, long time. I've been driving sustainability as a CEO and chairman, and I'm still driving it as a chairman, because among my direct reports, there's the sustainability director, because it's something where I believe in, and I think it's going to be also the next big thing. In a way, I have a feeling that e-commerce is a kind of a mature business, you know? So e-commerce is everyday life. There's not so much more to reinvent and to invent. While on sustainability, we are probably at the beginning of a long story with a lot of inventions and a lot of innovations. What we do with the brands that we partner with, yes, as I mentioned before, so we have this manifesto for our own brands, which constrains with the framework in which we operate. And we try also to instill this culture of sustainability also to our brands, which is a slow process, in the sense that, I mean, one thing is to do it on your own, and one thing is to go to Prada or Gucci and say, you know what, I'm going to stock your product only if they're fully sustainable. But what I see from the fashion industry, I mean, the fashion industry is an industry that in the last 20 years I admire a lot, because they've been always pretty fast in understanding and in detecting the customer appetite. And I think speaking with many CEOs of the fashion industry every day, there's 90% of them that they understand that especially the new generation are super, super, super conscious in terms of sustainability. And so they know that if they wanted to continue to grow, they need to change. So it's not an opportunity anymore, it's more a necessity for them. So what we do is something, but they know also by themselves. This is what I wanted to say. In terms of government, I think that the government will, more and more in the years to come, will push sustainability in the different sectors. So as I mentioned, Terra Carta by Prince Charles. Prince Charles is not a government, but still he acts as a government in a way. And Macron, Draghi, Biden, the first thing that he has done since the election is to rejoin the Paris Accord about sustainability. It's been like one of the most important things, the first thing that he has done. So I think that also government are doing on their own many, many things, and in the years to come. So I think that everything will converge. And that's why I mentioned that it's going to be the next big thing.
I think our time is, if you have a very quick question and very quick answer.
I was actually, I know Federico's got to go. I was going to say, there's been a bunch of people asking for two words of advice or three words of advice to a bunch of 22 to 35 year olds in their careers. What would you tell them right now? And then we'll let you go.
No, it's important. And actually, that's why I'm here. So I'm here not to promote my company, but I'm here to help people on the other side of the screen at least with some advice through my speech and by telling my story. For me, it's a way also to give back in terms of, let's say, all the things that I've done and the luck that I had. So I'm happy to answer to this question, even if I'm going to be late at dinner with my little daughter, that she insisted that I had to be home by 7:30, otherwise she wanted to eat by herself. I decided, for example, in terms of mentors, I decided not to have one mentor, because the world is so global and so fast changing and so diverse that the first advice that I would give to the students is to put together a very diverse mix of mentors, both geographically, but also in terms of different disciplines. So I had I remember that I've learned from so many people during these 20 years, because I started from zero, from nothing. As I mentioned, I was an outsider in fashion, I was an outsider in technology. So I've learned from a Napolitan stockist, as well as from the fashion critic of the New Yorker, which is one of the most influential magazines still around, and from architects in terms of how to make a website, rather than going to the web designer, I went to true architects, because in the end, I thought that it was good to make it different. So I think this is probably an advice that I do believe. So definitely try to put together a very diverse mix of mentors. And try to think, which is the second advice, try to think global as much as you can, because now the world is so interconnected that if I had started with Yuke's only in Italy, it wouldn't have been a success story. It would have been just a small startup that probably after 2 years would have died. But to think global, first European, then I launched in America in 2003, in Japan 2004, in China in 2009. So definitely, if you are American, you have a bigger market than just Italy. But it's not enough. The world is so interconnected, and I think it's important to think global, but at the same time also like knowing the local cultures and the local customers, that they are very different from each other.
Thank you so much for that. Thank you very much. We apologize to your daughter and to you for delaying supper tonight. But I know all the students really appreciate, and we all really appreciate the opportunity to get a chance to hear from you, to hear about your journey and to hear about your vision for the world and for the fashion and luxury industry, especially. So again, on behalf of all of us here at NYU Stern and everyone around the world who is tuning in to watch this video, we all thank you very much. We really appreciate you taking the time to spend with us. And so thank you. And again, thanks to Max and to Tamai for helping to set this whole thing up.
Thank you, Matt. Thank you, JP. Thank you, Tomai. Thank you, all the students. It was really my honor and my pleasure to be with you tonight.
Great.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Bye.